I was born at the Kiowa Indian Hospital in Lawton, Oklahoma, taken to my grandmother's place, and they lived in conditions of dire poverty. I didn't know it at the time. We didn't have any electricity or plumbing. And I grew up on Indian reservations. I was born during the Depression. My parents were looking for work. They found it with what was then called the Indian Service, the Bureau of Indian Affairs. So I lived on the Navajo Reservation when I was little, and I lived on two of the Apache reservations, and lived at the Pueblo of Jemez for the longest period of time. So I had a pan-Indian experience before I knew what that term meant. And it turned out to be fortunate, I think, in terms of writing, because I had an unusual experience, and a very rich one, of the southwestern landscape, the Indian world, and that became, for me, a very important subject. I might have a hard time cataloging all of the things that did make a difference, but certainly I can point to an understanding of the relationship between man and the landscape, for example. That I grew up with that, and that's such an important equation in the Indian world. So I think that has been of great value to me all my life. The Indian world is full of aesthetic values, art. My father was an artist, a painter, and he taught children at Jemez Pueblo painting. And they exhibited all over the world. They became famous, you know, for their art. And he once said to me, "You know, Scott, I have never known an Indian child who couldn't draw." So, you know, I believe that. I haven't either. That seems intrinsic somehow. And that's a real part of the Indian world, this love of symmetry and composition. It's a great thing. So I that has been important to me as well. Sense of humor. You know, Indian people have a strong sense of humor. It's not easily understood by other people, but it's there. And I love that. You know, that's been a part of my life too. Every boy who grows up in New Mexico, especially, you know, southern New Mexico, I suppose, knows about Billy the Kid. He's a real presence, an authentic legend. And so when I was growing up, I spent a lot of time with Billy the Kid. You know, we rode the range together. And that was an aspiration. When I was 12 years old, I was, like Alexander, given a horse. There the comparison ends. But that horse meant everything to me. It was one of my great glories. And I must have ridden several thousands of miles on the back of that horse in a period of about 5 years. And that was certainly a great time in my life. And so my imagination ran wild with cowboys and Indians. And I discovered a book by Will James called Smokey, The Story of a Cowhorse. That was my first great literary experience. I could not put that book down. And when I had finished it, I read everything I could get my hands on by Will James, Sun Up, all kinds of cowboy. And they were the writing was terrible, but the books were wonderful. And so made a great difference in my life too. Well, you know, being the descendant of centaurs, I have always understood the value of a horse from the time my father began telling me stories, you know. A lot of them were about horses, and horses have always been very important to me. I was interested in sports when I was a boy too, you know, and I was inspired by Joe Louis. I thought, hey, this guy he's the real thing. I still think he could beat Muhammad Ali. I had heroes like that, you know, when I was growing up. Inspiring, I would have to go back to somebody like Will James and say, yeah, I was inspired by these stories and what they meant and how they were put together. I think I learned a lot about storytelling, not only from the Kiowa oral tradition, which my father passed on to me, but also in those things that I read, you know, including classic comics and things like that. Yeah. They were all important. Yes, not in the early years. I can't really point to anyone before college, I think. But in college and in graduate school, I had several teachers who were very important to me. I remember when I was an undergraduate, I took a course in South American history from a woman, Dr. Woodward it was, Dorothy Woodward. And it was the hardest course I've ever taken. I mean, she was so demanding. But at the end of the term, I realized that I had really learned something, and that was exciting to me. And then, of course, Ivor Winters at Stanford was a great, not only a man who was inspiring, but turned out to be a very good friend, too. He was a great friend. I've always gotten along with classmates. I had some very strange... I was in schools that were remarkable in one way or another. I was, for example, many times the only person who had... for whom English was a first language. You know, I was in school with a lot of Pueblo kids and Navajo kids, and so they spoke a kind of broken English, and I didn't. And so I suppose that was... to my advantage in some ways, but disadvantage in others, because I wasn't really challenged when I was in the early grades. And that's pretty much true all up through through high school. When it came time to go to college, I think I was ill-prepared for college. You know, I hadn't had a lot of really valuable training. So it came as a kind of shock to me. But I managed to do what I was supposed to do. I wasn't a great student. I didn't care that much about grades until I got into graduate school. And then I thought, well, you know, the time has come to really make an effort now. And so I did. And I was able to, which is more important. I had by that time put myself in a position where I could, you know, hold my own. I was in all kinds of different schools, some on the reservation, some off. I went to four different high schools, and for two of those years, I rode a bus 28 miles one way to school, and boarded with an old German couple in Albuquerque in my sophomore year, and then I went to military school for my senior year, for the reason that I had run out of schools and that my parents and I thought that... you better do something. If you really want to go to college, you better go to a school that can give you some college preparation. And so I selected a military academy in Virginia, and I went there my senior year. It was a romantic kind of thing. My mother was born in Kentucky, and some of her ancestors had come from Virginia. And so she was always very much interested in that part of the world and in that part of her ancestral experience. And so I had a kind of interest in the Old South and the Old Dominion. And so when I got these catalogs, that's where I gravitated, you know, to Shenandoah Valley. What happened when I was young, and kids take things like that for granted. You know, if it had happened to me at a later time in my life, I probably would have been terrified. But going back and forth from between the Indian world and the white man's world was a piece of cake, you know, at the time. It's like learning a language. You know, language is child's play. And the kind of experience I had was child's play. As I look back on it, because... I was very frequently among Indians who were not of my tribe, and we couldn't converse, you know, we didn't have the same language. But I always had a sense of being one of them, you know, because I'm Indian. And they had the same sense of me. You know, we got along well because we were all Indians together. And that's something I think that is of importance, and something that happened in my lifetime. When I was little, people didn't think of themselves as Indians. They thought of themselves as Kiowas or Comanches or Crees or whatever. But in the last 50 years or so, the tribal distinctions have broken down, but the sense of Indianness has remained as strong as ever, and maybe it has become stronger. And I can't account for that except to say that, well, yeah, you know, the outside world has made incursions, and the Indians have left the reservation, and so there's been a much greater kind of communication back and forth. And now we have things like powwows, which are extremely important in bringing young people especially together from every kind of different tribe and language. And they trade words and dance steps and music and so on. And so they become, they bond and become a people instead of the members of a lot of different tribes. And I think that's healthy. One of the things that amazes me at times is that I think the Indian is more secure than he was a half century ago, has a much better idea of himself and of the contribution that he can make. And he's only 2% of the population and has, I think, an influence much greater than that would indicate. I think that I was lucky. I am lucky because I do have a sense of my heritage, my Indian heritage. That's very firmly fixed in my imagination and in my mind. And I believe that I am fortunate, more fortunate than most other people. I remember when I published The Way to Rainy Mountain, someone who was writing a review or interviewing me said to me, you know, you're very lucky to know who you are with respect to, you know, your grandparents, your great-grandparents, five generations back. You know about that. I don't know that about myself or my people. And that came as a surprise to me because I hadn't thought about it, you know, and I had taken it for granted. But I sometimes think that, you know, the contemporary white American is more culturally deprived than the Indian in that sense, as very few people know about their ancestry, going back even a generation. I'm always appalled by students who, you know, I say, well, look, you've got an oral tradition, you've got a family oral tradition, if nothing else. Tell me about your grandparents. And sometimes they just don't know about their grandparents, and I find that very sad and alarming. But it's true. It's true. Maybe that's how it works, that this country is made up of people who do have, you know, both things, or the possibility of both things. I don't think they appreciate that enough at this point, and that we need to talk to them about that. Spend some time thinking about who you are and how you became who you are. That's important to you. But we're moving at such a pace that very few of us stop to think about that, to reflect upon it. Reflection is important. It means a great deal, actually, and the reason it does has something to do with my being a Native American. I belong to a race of people, a society that has been oppressed. We, the Indians, have had a hard time for a long time. We have had to endure a great deal. But the dream means as much to us as it does to anyone. And you'll never find a greater patriot than an American Indian, you know. It's not by accident that I, the member of the Gourd Dance Society, go to Oklahoma to dance on the 4th of July, you know. It is not an accident that the greatest honor that can come to an American Indian in my generation is to serve in the armed forces, you know. And the veterans who have given their lives are greatly honored by the Native people. So the dream is very important to me, and it is, I think, to Native Americans in general. I don't think Stanford saw anything in me particularly, but Ivor Winters did. Ivor Winters was the man who chose the poets for the fellowship. And I sent him, when I applied, I didn't know him at the time. I submitted several poems, I guess, and the outline for a collection of poems. And he saw in it something that he wanted to encourage. So he wrote to me and said, "You've been awarded the Poetry Fellowship." There was only one that year. This was 1959. I had not wanted to go on with my schooling. I had graduated from the University of New Mexico with a BA. I had taken a job on the Jicarilla Apache Reservation, teaching, and I was quite pleased to be there. I spent a year and loved it. Wonderful setting, great people. The kids were wonderful. I was teaching 7th graders up through 11th or 12th graders. And I was a bachelor, earning the princely sum of $4,000 a year. Nothing to spend it on, except steaks down at the trading post. I'd go buy the best piece of meat you've ever seen, you know, bring it home and feast on it. But then I won the fellowship to Stanford. And I thought, hey, I'll go to Stanford, I'll live off the fat of the land there for a year, I'll learn something about writing, it's a great opportunity, but then I'll come back here. I took a year's leave of absence. And I meant to be gone for a year. I ended up staying 20 years in California because Ivor Winters talked me into going through the mill there, so I took the bachelor's and then stayed in and took the doctorate. And by that time, I was overqualified for Dulce, so I got into the business of college teaching. I was writing in a kind of native voice. I had already become interested in the Indian oral tradition, and I wanted to incorporate elements of that tradition into my work. And I think he thought that was exciting, had interesting possibilities, and responded very favorably to it. That was an important moment in my life because he was extremely knowledgeable about poetry. I was very much interested in poetry at the time. And he was in a position to take me over and help me, you know, learn poetic forms and so on. That was a turning point. Poetry, it seems to me, and I'm pretty sure I'm right about this, is the crown of literature. It's to write a great poem is to do as much as you can do in literature. Everything has to be very precise. The poem has to be informed with motive and emotion. So you're bringing everything that literature is based upon to bear when you write a poem. And I think of myself as a poet. I'd rather be a poet than a novelist or some other sort of writer. I think I'm more recognized as a novelist simply because I won a prize. But I write poetry consistently, though slowly. And it seems to me the thing that I want to do best. I think it's the highest of the arts, the literary arts. a poem, if it succeeds, if it is what it ought to be, brings together the best of your intelligence, the best of your articulation, the best of your emotion. And that's, you know, what that is the highest goal of literature, I suppose. I would rather be a poet than a novelist, because I think it's on a slightly higher plane. You know, poets are the people who really are the most insightful among us. They stand in the best position to enlighten us and encourage and inspire us. And what better thing could you be than a poet? You know, that's how I think of it. I knew that I wanted to be a writer from a very early age. I think because my mother was a writer and, you know, encouraged me to write. And so I accepted that. I got it in my head that, yeah, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to be a writer. But then there was a lot of serendipity, too, after that, you know, getting into place, one thing happening, moving into different settings that inspired the writing. A lot of things happened that I could not have expected. They definitely encouraged me. It challenge is too strong a word. I mean, I don't think they applied pressure to me, but my mother certainly tried to interest me in good books, and she did. And gave me an incentive to write. My father was very very gentle. He was a very gentle man, and he never told me that he expected this or that of me. But, you know, he encouraged me, and I learned a lot about painting by watching him, osmosis. And I didn't follow in his footsteps for a long time, but now I'm a painter and a printmaker, and it all comes from him. Silent, a kind of silent encouragement, but there. I think they, again, in a kind of a quiet way, they gave me praise. You know, they were pleased when I published something. They were pleased when I was recognized. They didn't throw parties, but nonetheless, I could tell that it was a good thing as far as they were concerned. It's important to me because I am who I am. I have a certain temperament. I was born with certain potential and possibilities, and I have been fortunate in realizing some of those possibilities. I was inspired to write at a tender age by my mother, who was a writer. I was fortunate to that extent, and I did follow in her footsteps and develop a voice, the voice of a writer. that's what a writer does. I tell young people often, don't worry about having a distinctive voice right now. It comes with experience and practice. You will develop a voice. Someone once said to me, "Don't worry about imitating someone. That's how you learn, and eventually you will verge out and go on your own voice." So I simply kept my goal in mind and persisted. Perseverance is a large part of writing. And so what success I have achieved has come about because of that, simply following the line. I wanted to succeed. I wanted to write well, and I tried to. I applied myself. I think that writers haven't much choice if someone is really, if he has the impulse to write, then that's what he must do. I don't think there's much of a choice after that impulse is realized. He writes, and that's how I feel about my development. I think that I was compelled to write, and so there wasn't a. I never had the choice of doing anything else, really. And I was talking to some kids here today at lunch, and they were talking about happiness. One of them was saying that, well, I'm going to Harvard and I'm going into science, but I'm not sure that's really what I want to do. I sort of, I want to be happy, and I might be happy doing any number of other things, you know. And I thought, yeah, that's true in a way, but if you are really impelled or compelled to write, say, you know, that's where happiness is. It's in doing what you can do and being the best you can be, you know, being the best you can be at it that really makes for, I don't know if I'd use the word happiness, but James Earl Jones today talked about contentment. There is certainly a contentment, a satisfaction in doing what you can do, you know. There's a lot of frustration in writing. I heard an interview with a writer not long ago in which the interviewer said, "Tell me, is writing difficult?" And the writer said, "Oh, no, of course not." He said, "All you do is sit down at a typewriter, you put a page into it, you know, and then you look at it until beads of blood appear on your forehead. That's all there is to it." There are days like that, but when you come away after 2 or 3 hours with a sentence or two or three, and you understand in your heart that those are the best sentences you could have written in that time, there is a satisfaction to that that is like nothing else. That justifies everything. I think that there are people who have a kind of intrinsic love of language. They're born with it. It's a gift of God, if you want. And for those people, you know, nothing is as gratifying as writing. And most people, in my experience, most people who have had that gift know it, and they celebrate it, which is what ought to happen. I think Emily Dickinson knew absolutely that she had a great, great endowment, and that was her life. It is only incidental that she published 5 or 7 poems in her lifetime. She knew she was a poet and one of the best. That had to mean a great deal to her. I've had a number of different kinds of problems in my life, which I guess you could call setbacks, because I'm sure that they did get in the way of my work. I've gone through 2 divorces, for example, which were debilitating in their way. I have had fits of depression. Things of that kind, they got in the way, but I didn't know how to deal with them. In every case, it was largely a matter of waiting it out. You know, people speak of writer's block. I guess that one could say that after I published my first novel and was awarded the Pulitzer Prize, I found it very difficult to write after that for a long time. And yet I'm the one who says, well, I don't believe in writer's block. That's an excuse of some kind. It doesn't really exist. So I don't know. I just waited until I could write again, and it happened. And that's how it's been off and on through my whole career. Things get in the way, and I had a heart attack a little over a year ago now, a mild one, thank goodness, angioplasty, and that got in the way for a time. But, you know, now I'm back to writing and being productive, and That's what matters to me. All writers probably are a bit insecure all of the time, and very insecure much of the time. But you work against that. That's just how the game is played. You know, you can't let yourself bog down permanently into such a state of despair or ennui or whatever it is. You have to work against it. And we get back to the idea of the writer having to write. I once read something by Kafka, a letter in which he said something to this effect. God doesn't want me to write, but I have to write. And so there's this terrible tug of war, and you know who wins. But I can't help it. It's just something I have to do. And I that's pretty much my philosophy, too. I deal with it very well now, but there was a time when I didn't. I think when I first started publishing, you know, I was deeply concerned with what other people thought of my writing. But I then came to realize, just as you've said, that a lot of people are not going to like what you do, no matter what it is. If some do, you're all right, you know. I was extremely lucky because early in my career I was given a lot of recognition, and when I got the Pulitzer Prize, it did inhibit me in certain ways, but at the same time it alleviated a lot of the problems that come with a young professor. You know, I no longer had to worry about publishing or perishing. I no longer had to worry about, I did have to worry about junk mail and getting invitations to ladies' garden societies, and that still goes on. That's the negative side of it. But I established myself very early, and that was a good thing. It sort of cleared the way for my work. And when I finally could get back to writing, it was, you know, I was free to do it. At one time, it made a difference. I paid close attention to it. Now I don't so much. I keep, there are a lot of things that are written about me that I don't read, and about my work. People will say, well, what did you think of that article? And I say, well, I don't know. What did it say? Who said what about my writing? I don't pay much attention to it, is the point now, you know. And I think I'm better off for that, because it's dangerous to go around reading opinions of your work, of your worth and your work. You can get in trouble doing that. It's best to shut that off and get on with your work. I think it takes a lot of resolve. I think you have to believe in what you're doing, and you have to do it to the best of your ability. And that calls for, you know, reaching down inside yourself and coming up with resolve, determination. That may be the most important thing as I think of it. Writing is a way of expressing your spirit, so there's much more to it than the question of material success. You are out to save your soul, after all, and be the best thing that you can be in your whole being, you know. In the plains culture, which is my ancestral culture, and a warrior culture, there were four principles. A warrior had to live by these principles: bravery, fortitude, generosity, and virtue. And when I learned about those principles, they have been extremely important to me. You know, I would like to live my life according to those four things. And I would like to do it in my writing as well as in my other activity. So that's what I believe, and I would tell and do tell students, you know, writing is the expression of your spirit, but you must live by certain ideals, and they must inform not only your writing but the way in which you have breakfast with your mate as well. I like for my work to be recognized and appreciated. But in a greater sense, I think it's taken too seriously by many people. It begins to be an end in itself, and that's wrong. That's wrong. If you can do your own work and satisfy your own demands, then the acclaim, you know, if it's there, it's great. If it's not, it doesn't matter that much. As long as you can be true to yourself and save your own soul, that's what really matters. There are certain things that concern me deeply. One of them is the way we treat our environment. That disturbs me greatly, because I think we haven't done a very good job in protecting our planet. We have failed to recognize the spiritual life of the Earth. I want to see that turned around. I'm not sure that it will be turned around, but that's something I think of a great deal. I feel a sense of futility, because I think there's not much I can do about it, but I can do something, and you know, that's if, and I will, to the best of my ability, try to change that. I'm not at all confident that I can, but if I make the effort, that will mean something. I want to produce a certain amount of work. I think I have things left to do. And as I grow older, it becomes a race. You know, that's something of concern to me. Will I be able to do the things that I've set for myself to do? And who knows? But that's something of concern to me too. I have certain writing projects that I want to complete. Certain things going on. I'm just now beginning a play that has been commissioned by the Denver Theater Center, and I want to come up with a first draft of that. But that's something that I think I can do with a little luck. That doesn't bother me so much. I'm not that advanced in age as yet. But some long-term things. I want to write a novel based on the 60s, which seems to me the most important decade of this century to date, and it looks like it's going to hold up. I lived in California during the 60s, and it was a very important time in our history, I think. You know, you stop to think about what happened in that decade, and it boggles the mind. We had those terrible assassinations. We had the civil rights movement, and we ended up by going to the moon. You know, that was a good time in which to have lived, and I want to write about that. But it's on the back burner. I'm not sure when I'm going to get to that, or how long it will take to put it out. But I would like to do it. I hope I will. Fix your sight upon something, and then go after it, and try not to be deflected. You have something that most of us don't have, and that is time. You have time in which to deliberate, time in which to reflect, time in which to determine who you are. Use it. You know, don't panic. And a lot of kids tend to panic, you know. But I say, just take it easy, but go for something, you know. Move positively towards some goal that you would like to achieve. And always think, you know, ask yourself how you would like to be known. Don't let yourself be determined by others. And this is especially true where young people are concerned, because everybody wants to determine them, and they have very few defenses against that. So I say, for God's sake, you know, don't let other people tell you who you are. If I had let people tell me who I was, I would never, you know, have, I would have dropped back there somewhere. But determine who you are, and don't let anybody else do it for you. That's the best advice I can give a young person, I think. Oh dear, how can I answer that without... I would say probably... that's an impossible question. You can read the collected works of William Shakespeare and find out a great deal about life and the world and the way people act in each other's presence. You can read the Bible to the same effect. I probably would want to aim a little lower than those things, though, and say, why don't you read Moby Dick? And if you can read that and not be somehow fulfilled, then there's something wrong with you.